I'm the acting director this year of Law and Public Affairs. I'm also an associate professor here in the Politics Department. It gives me great privilege to host our panel today, the title of which is Are Financial Institutions Too Big or Too Big to Fail? We have a very distinguished set of panelists, and I will introduce the moderator momentarily. But let me first let you know that our program today is sponsored both by the Law and Public Affairs Program. We focus on a broad range of issues at the intersection of law and public affairs and public policy, as well as the Julius Rabinowitz Center for Public Policy and Finance, also here at the Wilson School, of which is one of our newest programs, a multidisciplinary research center that seeks to interject cutting-edge research on financial markets and macroeconomy into policy debates. I'm now going to introduce our moderator, Linda Goldberg, who in turn will then introduce the rest of our distinguished panel. Linda Goldberg is the class of 88, is Vice President of Financial Intermediation at the Federal Reserve Bank in New York, a Research Associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research. She's the Director of the Center for Global Banking Studies at the Federal Reserve Bank in New York City, the Co-Chair of the International Banking Research Network, and member of the Council on the International Monetary System of the World Economic Forum. She was a professor of economics at NYU, a visiting professor at Penn, and she has a PhD from here at Princeton University. She also, prior to that, received a bachelor's and a master's in mathematics and economics at Queens College, at CUNY, City University of New York. So please join me in welcoming Professor Goldberg.
So thank you all for coming out today, and welcome to this very special event on Are Financial Institutions Too Big or Too Big to Fail? Today you're going to hear from a very distinguished panel. Before introducing the panelists, I thought it would work to set the stage a little bit for why we're here today, giving you some issues and terminology especially, and just a disclaimer, whatever I say are my views and not those of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York or Federal Reserve System. So I have to say that. So we're here to talk about the financial system here in the United States. This has evolved dramatically over time. One part of it, as has long been the case, is comprised of many small banks. These banks take deposits. They engage in lending and other traditional activities. In addition to those small institutions, there are a lot of larger institutions, and their size and scope have changed tremendously. A wave of bank consolidations and other changes through the 90s and 2000s resulted in the growth of some very large entities, with large often taken to be more than $50 billion. In assets per institution, but the balance sheets of these institutions can be much larger. They could be in the hundreds of billions of dollars. They could be $2 to $3 trillion dollars per institution. These institutions take deposits and they lend. They provide a broad range of financial services. They participate in derivatives transactions, guarantees, loan syndications, trading activity, and they can have extensive international networks as well. Many of these banks are often viewed as complex institutions, although the meaning of complexity is less clearly defined. These banks are usually part of a larger corporation called a bank holding company, and these bank holding companies can often have hundreds of separate legal entities within the organization. But these numbers, too, can climb very high as 2,000 to 3,000 separate legal entities under a single bank holding company. These entities span banking, non-bank financial services. They include insurance companies, mutual funds, and even completely non-financial firms like manufacturing and commodities to some degree. So when we think of bank holding companies, it's much broader than the traditional kind of bank that you might have in mind. History is rife with bank failures and banking crises, and these arise when the banking system itself becomes compromised. The most recent event is fresh in all of our memories. It's the largest since the Great Depression. And these come on the heels of the world's biggest banks having grown in size and riskiness with lower capital, less stable funding, more complexity, and more trading activity. The crisis elicited a broad range of interventions from the U.S. government and, in fact, governments around the world to limit the damage that large bank failures can do to others in the financial system, but also to others outside the financial sector, for example, by disrupting the flow of credit that supports all kinds of activities in the private sector, whether it's loans for business working capital, investment activity, mortgages, student auto loans, and so on. And evidence from the US and from around the world shows that these types of disruptions can be devastating. Thus, we have the concept of too big to fail in banking institutions that has become much broadly a part of our lingo. A criticism in general is that in banks, profits went on the upside to the industry and losses on the downside could be shouldered by the public. So we've had a lot of reforms in the aftermath of the crisis, in part with the goal of making financial institutions safer, that is, reducing the risk of their failures, but also along the lines of limiting the damage and the potential for costly government interventions in the event that those institutions do fail and do get into trouble. So have recent reforms done away with the problem of too big to fail or not? How should large financial institutions and other institutions be regulated? So we have a distinguished panel here to give you perspectives. I'm going to introduce all now, and then we'll have each give you remarks in turn. We'll start with Paul Volcker, class of 1949. That's a big reunion. Let's give that a hand. Volcker served as two terms as chairman of the Federal Reserve under Presidents Carter and Reagan, where he is credited with bringing a very high level of inflation to an end. On the heels of the 2007 financial crisis, Paul served as economic advisor to President Obama and chairman of the Economic Recovery Advisory Board. During this time, he proposed changes to the law to prohibit proprietary speculative trading activity by banks or bank-owned institutions for their own gain rather than for the benefit of the consumer. The Volcker Rule became part of the Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act. And in 2013, Paul launched the Volcker Alliance to address ineffective public policies and distrust in government. Dick Herring, PhD, 1973, is a Jacob Safra Professor of International Banking and Professor of Finance at the Wharton School, University of Pennsylvania, where he is also the founding director of the Wharton Financial Institution Center. He is the author of more than 150 articles, monographs, and books on various topics in financial regulation, international banking, and international finance. Dick is co-chair of the U.S. Shadow Financial Regulatory Committee and executive director of the Financial Economists Roundtable. He is also a member of the FDIC's Systemic Resolution Advisory Committee, the Systemic Risk Council, and the Hoover Institution Working Group on Resolution Policy. Marty Gruenberg, class of 75, is the 20th chairman of the FDIC, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. Following other senior roles he held at that institution since 2005. Marty joined the FDIC board after broad congressional experience in the financial service and regulatory areas, including as senior counsel to Senator Paul Sarbanes on the staff of the Senate Committee on Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs from 1993 to 2005. Marty advised the senator on issues of domestic and international financial regulation, monetary policy, and trade. He played an active role in major legislation, including the Financial Institutions Reform, Recovery, and Enforcement Act of 1989, FIREA, the FDIC Improvement Act of 1991, FIDICHA, the Graham-Leach-Bliley Act, and the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002. Last but not least, Don Bernstein, class of 1975, is a partner with Davis, Polk, and Wardwell in New York, where he's head of the firm's Insolvency and Restructuring Practice Group. His firm has represented the U.S. Treasury and the New York Fed in connection with AIG since 2008. Don was separately representing their private sector clients, first trying to pull together the industry credit facility for Lehman before the original deal with Barclays fell apart over the Lehman weekend, and then helping them to sort out the mess afterwards. He works with large, systemically important financial institutions on developing their resolution plans, that is what they would do in the event of failure. He's a past chair of the National Bankruptcy Conference, a commissioner on the ABI Commission to study the reform of Chapter 11 Bankruptcy Code, a director of the International Insolvency Institute, and past director of the American College of Bankruptcy. He's been treasurer and member of the executive committee of the Association of the Bar of New York City, former chair of the city's Bar Association's Committee on Bankruptcy and Corporate Reorganization. So you have quite a panel to comment on these issues. Each panelist will speak for 10 minutes, then we'll have some back and forth among the panelists and later take questions from the audience. So we'll start with Paul and then move on to Dick, Don, and Martin.
Well, thank you, member and Princetonians of all ages and size and sex, I guess. You know, this is a reunion period, and you reminisce when you think of reunions. And it occurred to me yesterday that I would be coming to McCosh 50. I remember coming to McCosh 50 almost precisely 69 years ago as a freshman at Princeton. 69 years ago, my fellow panelists were not born. Now, I remember I was here to take what you think of as a proverbial course, Economics 101. Some of you may think, given what's happened since then, I wasn't listening very well. But the fact is, and I remember, it was not the, what you think of as Economic 101 today when they're teaching you all these equations and consumption and investment, all that stuff. It was a course in comparative economic systems, which started several thousand years ago. And I remember going through the feudal years and learning about how the Lord maintained control over the serfs and how the various guilds developed to as part of the system. And eventually, at the end of the course, we did get up to Karl Marx. I doubt if that's touched upon very often now at Princeton, but it was then. Anyway, we had two questions given to us, and let me just begin this colloquy. First question, too big. Are banks too big? Financial institutions too big? Well, the obvious answer is some of them are. And it's also a question of complexity. If they're very big and very complex, you have to be a genius to run it correctly. And not just an intellectual genius, you have to be a superb manager, and I don't think there are very many of those. So yes, you've got a problem of size. I'm not saying I have the answers to it, but and it's a limited problem in the sense there aren't many of these institutions. Too big to fail. Now that's an interesting question. It's obviously got great political resonance. Everybody talks about too big to fail, and that's a bad thing. But what do we really mean by too big to fail? If an institution, a financial institution, gets in trouble and the stockholders are wiped out for all practical purposes, is that failure? If that doesn't satisfy you, suppose the stockholders are wiped out and the management is gone. Is that the definition of failure we're talking about? Or do we insist that there be some loss to creditors too, and that really means failure? Or suppose the government comes along and pushes a merger on the institution. Is that failure or not? What are the terms? Or is it just liquidation? You've got to wipe the institution off the face of the earth and get it liquidated. That is failure. But is that really what we're talking about? And what are we talking about when we're talking about? Related question is, what's a bailout? If there's any phrase used more often than too big to fail, it's bailout. What's bailout mean? Is every time the government assists a financial institution, it's a bailout? You can't say that because the Federal Reserve does that almost every day, Linda, I think. One way or another, the FDIC occasionally helps, but it would have to be extraordinary government assistance of any sort. And is that what makes it a bailout that we should worry about? Or does it matter whether the government gets its money all back at a profit, as sometimes happens? If the government gets its money back, is it then put in a different category? It's not a bailout. And all these confusions, I think, enter into the popular conversation. And of course, the question is, why do we care at all about too big to fail or bailouts or all this stuff? Well, I'm sure the other panelists will be going into this in more detail, but if you want to hear a vigorous defense of government intervention, you can get Mr. Guyton's recent book, where by a lot of the definitions I guess gave you, there were failures and there were certainly bailouts, and he argues for this is all necessary, as all bailouts are justified by saying we did this to avoid further disturbance in the markets that would have been damaging not only to other financial institutions, but damaging ultimately to economic activity and citizens right around the country and maybe right around the world. And so that's why we justify intervention. And what is so bad about it when it happens? Well, we are worried, I understand, by we help one institution, and it's likely to be a very large institution. What about other institutions that aren't helped? Will they be adversely affected by the concerns that are raised by the immediate fears of the failure of a big institution? And that may be handled in a way by being prepared to do more and more bailouts, which doesn't sound very satisfactory. More generally, over a period of time, if an institution is saved, let me use that word, does that affect their own future behavior or the behavior of other institutions that said, well, we got saved, or other institutions said they got saved, we get saved too, and we will feel free to take more risks than we ordinarily would take because we will, as Linda said, we'll benefit from the upside and the government will take care of the downside. And then finally, I guess we can have other reasons, but I'll mention one that became very prominent in the 1980s. By a kind of slogan developed by the small banks. And they were the ones that really invented this business about too big to fail, and they said it's unfair competition because people will come to learn or suspect that big important institutions will be saved. You'll save Citibank, you'll save Morgan, you'll save Chase, you'll save Bank of America, but you're not going to save the First National Bank of Hohokus or even Princeton. And therefore, we are at an unfair advantage in the marketplace. People won't put money with us because they want to put it in an institution that's going to be saved. And I think that to anticipate maybe some of the discussion, there is real statistical measures now, after all that's happened, that the big banks and the big other institutions that might seem to qualify for too big to fail treatment, to use that terrible phrase, can actually finance themselves more cheaply than a smaller bank that may in effect be in a stronger financial position than the big bank. So that is a problem. Now, as we discuss this, I think you ought to be aware that I declare my interest. I don't know if it's a conflict of interest. But some people associate the beginning of this problem with use that terrible phrase, too big to fail, and bail out with a large Chicago bank in Chicago, Illinois, which we thought was very large then. By today's standards, it was not, but a lot of things have happened. Anyway, this big bank got in trouble. It had a possibility of affecting adversely a lot of other institutions and indeed the economy as a whole for a lot of complicated reasons. But I happened to be chairman of the Federal Reserve at that point. Marty Greenberg's predecessor is chairman of the FDIC. We were two peas in a pod or something in dealing with this problem. And the decision was made for a variety of reasons that indeed the combination of a large capital infusion by the FDIC and very large liquidity support by the Federal Reserve, we would save continental Illinois. Now, what does save mean? If we go back to my definition of what is a failure, the stockholders were wiped out. The management was gone. There was, in that case, no loss to creditors. There were very few creditors that were not deposited, but they were not lost. There was eventually a forced merger. And anyway, it happened. It happened and was followed by, or accompanied by, a major crisis, continuing crisis in the savings and loan industry. Principal suppliers of mortgage credit, who were fairly small institutions, which were failing rapidly. And then some of the smaller banks, as I mentioned, were worried. So that was when this argument became, or this discussion became very prominent. There were changes in law, but never before have we had such big intervention as during this recent crisis. I must say, and I don't know if it's defense, but just in the interest of accuracy, it is not technically true that Continental Illinois was the first bailout. A few years before that, it was First Pennsylvania Bank in Philadelphia, and there were a number of other occasions earlier, but certainly Continental Illinois got the attention. But there is an interesting comparison. In the 1930s, in the Great Depression, while individual banks were not so large relatively as now, there were a tremendous number of bank failures, to the point that when President Roosevelt took office, all the banks were closed. He said, there's such a panic about this, such a much uncertainty, we'll let things sit for a week or two or three until we can get the banking system going again. They did get the banking system going again, with maybe, a third of the banks never opened up the window again, but the economy gradually recovered. Now, that is the picture that many people today have in mind. See what happened in 1933, following the Great Depression, beginning to the Great Depression, and it ended up in a very prolonged depression. We must avoid this, so we will be more interventionist than was the case any time after, in the beginning in 1929, but continuing through 1933. So that, we have two test cases. Some people see it anyway as test cases. Let the market work its way out. If they fail, they fail. Rescue the market with all the problems that may entail. So, I leave that to my fellow panelists to tell you which course is the appropriate one.
Thank you, Linda, for that very kind introduction. It is never a good thing to be following Paul Volcker because he's got the definitive word on everything, but I'll try to give a sort of alternate view of some of the things that happened. I'm going to date the first use of the term too big to fail as the hearings that followed the collapse of continental Illinois, when the controller of the currency, Todd Conover, spent some awkward weeks in Congress explaining why it failed despite the fact that his institution had given Continental excellent supervision and had run the charter well. And at some point he said, well, you know, to be quite honest, 12 of our or 11 of our institutions are too big to fail. And that did wonders for the market value of at least 10 of them. But they weren't quite sure how he was counting size. And the 12th one was in a lot of trouble because it raised issues about who would be next. And it was, I think, really the first example of really the value of this implicit subsidy from being perceived as too big to fail. And I quite agree with Paul that this sort of thing had gone on before. I have real questions about whether there was any systemic argument for First Pennsylvania, but neither of us responsible for that. And Continental Illinois, let me remind you, was $42 billion and the fifth largest bank in the U.S., the largest commercial and industrial lender. Compare that to today, where J.P. Morgan Chase is somewhere north of $2 trillion, and you see what a different world we're living in. You can adjust all the price inflation you like and not get there. What do we really mean by too big to fail? Well, it's really a catch-all phrase that is intended to encompass, as Linda indicated, a wide variety of things. Some of them surely have to do with complexity. Several banks have more than 3,000 affiliates. Both Linda and I have looked at this pretty carefully, or as carefully as you can with the public data. And many of them have scores and scores of countries they're involved in. Citibank would be a good example of this. And one of the reasons that presents a problem is that simply to imagine how you would take all of those legal entities through some kind of resolution process is mind-boggling. And so that kind of complexity is very worrisome. Interconnectedness is another feature, and that usually applies to banks that are heavily involved in dealer markets, in derivative swaps, options, that sort of thing, which can be very opaque and very difficult to know exactly who's going to say ouch if one of the players goes down, because the interrelationships are changing rapidly and nobody's really quite sure of what the positions are. An example of that kind of bank might be Morgan Stanley. Other kinds of banks may be on the list because of the particular importance of the services they provide. Bank of New York Mellon is not very large, but it is crucial in the third-party repo market and in all sorts of clearing and transactions. And then, of course, there is just sheer size, like J.P. Morgan Chase. All of these banks were picked not at random, but because they're on the list that the Financial Stability Board manages of the global systemically important financial institutions. We have seven of them on the list, the largest of any country. I would say, despite all of these attempts to be analytical, as a practical matter, what determines whether an institution is too big to fail is the concern of regulators. And if when they look at the abyss, they fear that if loss were imposed on unsecured creditors or uninsured depositors, it would cause intolerable spillovers that would damage the financial system and the real economy, then that institution is too big to fail. They will do something to try to protect the economy from those consequences. So we might ask, what is it the regulators fear? And this is going to be trivializing it, but I think you'll get the point. First of it is sort of a loss of confidence in the banking system. This is, cartoonist captured this by having a teller ask at a potential customer, say, can I interest you in a faith-based account, which probably is not going to work. It could also lead to a banking panic of the sort that Polk talked about in the 30s. That doesn't happen so much in current days because of Marty's institution, the FDIC. You don't see retail depositors with this kind of anxiety, but you do see it in the wholesale markets because they really are very, very concerned about whether they can get out in time. And so the runs happen electronically and are really not as visible as they once were. On the other hand, you have the reverse phenomena, which is these days probably even more damaging, that banks are desperate to scramble for liquidity. It doesn't quite happen like this. The retail customers don't have enough money to be useful. But what it does happen is the institutional markets try to protect each other by raising the amount of collateral they want for collateralized loans, by increasing the haircuts, by selling assets, which inevitably leads to a fall in prices, which leads to more demand for collateral. And you see the interbank market simply collapse, as it did in August of 2007, because people know there are a lot of losses overhanging the system, but they don't really know who is going to bear the losses in the end. And finally, you have just a loss of confidence in the whole financial system. And this is very awkward if you're in the business of providing advice to the financial system. UBS may be the poster child of this kind of problem. They had the greatest private wealth management franchise in the world, yet they lost billions of dollars managing their own money, and it led to troubling questions about their competence to manage other people's money. We at Wharton had a particular poignant view of this because there was sort of collateral damage that affected some of our graduates fairly severely. There was a cutback of sorts, which has been difficult. But the important part that we need to focus on is exactly what Paul outlined in talking about the 30s experience, and that is where it really, where Wall Street hits Main Street. And this is the manager of a local bank who said, well, yes, we used to be called the Friendly Loan Company, but now it's the Go to Hell Loan Company. Well, what does it matter if some banks are deemed too big to fail? It is an implicit subsidy. We can, to some extent, quantify it. And as Paul indicated, it means that business is going to flow to institutions that are receiving the subsidy, not whether they're better managed or allocating credit better. And so you're going to have this distortion of the flow of resources that may lead to an inefficient allocation of resources in the economy. In addition, you're going to have a loss of market discipline. Now, Paul had some concerns about who you want to discipline the banks. I would argue that it's important for at least some creditors to discipline the banks because the regulatory authorities need that kind of support. And so that doesn't tend to happen when you have the presumption that it's something too big to fail. Let me only indicate what happened in the run-up to Lehman Brothers, which was able to fund itself until the very end, because people thought it was certain to be saved since Bear Stearns was saved. This enables institutions to leverage and grow, and it happens that some banks in some countries have grown so large that they're really too big to save. The Netherlands, Switzerland, the United Kingdom all have individual banks that have liabilities that are larger than the GDP of their country. But probably the most obvious example of this is Ireland, which ran into a banking problem, guaranteed all its deposits, got huge inflows from the rest of the euro area, and people began to notice that it was very, very large compared to Irish GDP. As a result, they turned a banking crisis into a sovereign debt crisis, and they're only just now coming up. The problem, of course, is all of this can be hugely costly to governments if they have to make good on the implicit guarantees. And you are in this position of distorted incentives where you have risky positions. As some people said at the time, the bonuses were real, the profits were not. Our accounting simply doesn't measure these things very well. And it leads people to take greater risks. This is known in the banking world as moral hazard. It's not about ethics. It's all about distorted incentives. And probably if you take Mervyn King, who was governor of the Bank of England, seriously, we have just gone through the most massive round of moral hazard in all history. This is a cartoon from the New Yorker that often gets it right, although I think this young man is a little optimistic. He's just smashed the piggy bank and says, now we just have to sit back and wait for the Fed to bail us out. He may be waiting a while. He's not big enough, frankly. Despite the recognition of the too-big-to-fail problem, we've seen rapid growth among these banks. By 2010, the five largest banks held more than half of all bank assets, and that's up from 15% in the 1970s. So the big have gotten bigger at a very rapid rate. And I would have to say that to some extent, that is a result of panicky, over-the-weekend government-facilitated mergers to try to make the short-term more stable than it would otherwise have been. But the cost has been a long-term system that I don't think we would have wanted to have. It's also very costly potentially, and Andy Haldane at the Bank of England actually measured this and found that at 2009, the US, Europe, and had committed the equivalent of 25% of world GDP to backing up the banking system. And one might ask whether, in fact, that is an appropriate way to allocate world GDP. Now, oddly enough, despite the fact this was a well-known problem, there was really nothing much done about it until the most recent legislation. There was total reliance on the doctrine of constructive ambiguity. And I believed it when Paul Volcker was at the Fed. There was a story that went round, and it may be apocryphal, but the important point is that it was widely believed. And it was a discussion between Paul and a banker who headed a very large institution. And it is said, and it may not be true, that the banker asked Paul what kind of support he could expect in the event of a crisis. And Paul said, well, I'll be happy to speak about that with your predecessor. With your successor, I'm sorry. With your successor. And that is how you end moral hazard. But I think in general, people don't have that credibility. And just as Paul said, it's very rare to find anybody who has a talent to manage one of these huge, complicated institutions. It's rarer still to have a public official with that kind of integrity and discipline. I think it's kind of a naive approach, because unless the markets really believe that policy will be determined by a roulette wheel, that it's actually going to be a random outcome, they're going to make assumptions based on the kind of cost-benefit analysis they think the regulators will go through. And it almost inevitably leads to helping large institutions, not small institutions. It's an example of the time inconsistency problem that really plagues the whole policymaking world, in that what you want people to believe ex ante may be very different than what you actually do ex post. And that creates a real credibility problem that can cause difficulties. I think we tested the policy of constructive ambiguity seriously during the recent crisis and found it was really destructive in the end. The whole policy came to an end when Lehman Brothers was sent to bankruptcy court, and frankly, much of the market was astonished, because Bear Stearns had been saved less than 6 months before. Bear Stearns was half the size, half as complex, and certainly the manager of Lehman Brothers was utterly sure that he would be supported and held out against a lot of attempts to recapitalize him. And after that, you saw a string of failures, which actually led to failures worldwide. And I would argue a lot of this happened because the probability of a bailout went from about 100% to maybe down to about 20%, which means that the risk premiums people want to put money in the banking system are going to go way up. Well, we do have a policy response, and this time it is explicitly addressed to too big to fail. It's multi-pronged, and let me just mention some of the elements of it, and then I will stop. We have heightened supervision. Now, we have always said that we're going to supervise banks more carefully. This time it seems to have more substance to it, especially with the introduction of the capital adequacy scenarios in which banks actually are asked to project their situation forward under severe scenarios. We also now have much higher and better quality capital requirements. And the capital requirements are differentially higher for institutions that are on the list of too big to fail. In fact, the Financial Stability Board sort of forms a list for that purpose, and it's supposed to apply to banks everywhere in the world. We now have liquidity requirements in place that also have scenarios underlying them, so that banks should be less vulnerable to a liquidity problem. We have activity restrictions, most notably the Volcker rule. And I would say the most important piece of it all, which really does speak to my definition of too big to fail, is an attempt to give policymakers an alternative to causing chaos, a way to resolve a large insolvent institution or a large near to insolvent institution, because it's really a range, not a point, without creating financial chaos. This is written into Dodd-Frank in Titles 1 and 2. It involves banks making living wills, which some of them sardonically recall as funeral plans, but it is supposed to give regulators and banks information to be able to deal with a very tough situation. Now, under Title I, they're supposed to go to bankruptcy court, and in fact, the living wills are aimed at bankruptcy. Don has been one of the leaders in trying to figure out how to make our bankruptcy laws better able to deal with financial institutions, because they do have very different characteristics than the normal run-of-the-mill institution. And then finally, you have Title II that can be used in exceptional circumstances for very large institutions with a number of safeguards to get there. And this is where Marty and his colleagues have made, I think, a really substantial and innovative contribution. They've actually figured out how they might do it for a large, internationally active institution that spans 40 or 50 or 60 countries. And we don't know if it will work, but it's so far the only idea out there that has any credibility at all. So I congratulate the organizers on having assembled a good panel. Everybody has a major role in it except me. I'm just a voyeur on the whole system. Thank you.
Now that I know I'm a funeral director, it's very heartening to know that. First of all, I want to point out, and Richard really mentioned it just now, what an extraordinary panel we have. We have two of the finest public servants in the United States, and they've been at it for quite a while. They are in Princeton's tradition of being in the nation's service and being in the service of all nations, and I really want to applaud them for that. And we also have one of the leading experts on financial services and the business of financial services. I'm just a bankruptcy lawyer, and I'm going to see what I can contribute here. But you may have second thoughts after you hear what I have to say. But what I'm going to focus on is that list of things that was in Richard's last slide, and in particular on the last item, because there were really two things that are needed to at least make an attempt to solve too big to fail. The first is active prudential regulation. And all of the items above the last item in Richard's last slide were about prudential regulation. How do we make banks more resilient? How do we make them less complex, more easily managed? How do we reduce their risk profiles so that they are less likely to fail? When I get to my area, I'm really talking about what happens when failure occurs. And I'd like to explore why it is so difficult for financial institutions to just go bankrupt the way other corporations do. Now, we have the most effective bankruptcy system in the world. We discovered in the 19th century how to reorganize companies. And what a reorganization of a company is simply a method of passing losses to the private sector, to shareholders, to creditors, and at the same time preserving the value of the enterprise, potentially preserving the jobs in the enterprise. And today, for large companies that are not financial services companies, our bankruptcy system is incredibly successful. Companies tend to get either reorganized and owned by the creditors as going concerns, or they get sold to third parties. Why can't that happen with financial institutions? There are several characteristics of financial institutions that make this very difficult. And each one of them was a characteristic that we saw in the Lehman Brothers situation. Richard mentioned runs, and I'm going to describe them in a little more detail because some people in the audience may not understand them. But runs on cash are the first thing that happens when there is a whiff of trouble. People will protect themselves, they're risk-averse, and they're ambiguity-averse. And in the context of a financial services firm as large and complex as the ones we're dealing with, people are so uncertain that they start pulling their money out. The second thing is, once people start pulling their money out, the financial institution has to find cash in order to satisfy those creditors. Depositors are creditors. So it ends up selling assets. And if it's selling assets in the context of a financial crisis, it's engaging in what we bankruptcy lawyers call fire sales, because you're usually selling an asset at the bottom of the market. And you are incurring a significant loss when you sell that asset. So you may have had a loss that started the run. Now you're going to have more losses as you effectively liquidate yourself in order to meet the run. Then something else happens which is quite unique to financial services. Financial service companies have trading contracts. We talked about derivatives a few minutes ago, but other types of trading contracts as well that terminate if you fail. So when a financial institution fails, there is another kind of run that occurs, which is all of these financial creditors who have derivatives and commodities contracts and securities contracts, which may be forward contracts, may be options, may be a bunch of other types of contracts, and have collateral for those contracts, in other words, they are secured by assets, have the opportunity to shut off those contracts and run and sell the collateral in the market, which, again, results in more fire sales and more losses. So you have this cascading effect of an initial lack of confidence, a run, and a loss to meet the run, and a further run, because once you try to go into resolution, all of these contracts terminate. Then you have the additional phenomenon of this happening in multiple countries. And it's not just that the runs are happening in multiple countries, but when you fail, you are being taken over by multiple parties. The UK subsidiary will have an administrator. The US bank will probably have Marty and his team of FDIC people. You will have your securities firm in the United States will be taken over by a SIPC trustee. And so it goes. So you have this balkanization of the firm as soon as it fails, and each of the relevant parties tries to preserve the local assets for the local creditors, something called ring fencing. So you then have another problem. You can't even run the firm cohesively at that point. So you really can't reorganize it. And then finally, when all of this is going on, nobody is about to begin providing new liquidity or new loans to the financial services firm that's in this condition. So it's a perfect storm. You're liquidating your assets, you're incurring more losses, you have suddenly become balkanized, and no one's able or willing to lend you money. And that's what happens under ordinary circumstances and what happened in 2008 to Lehman Brothers. And there was no way of stopping a meltdown liquidation with huge losses. So the question is, how do we stop it? Well, let's talk about runs. Runs are, you know, if you think about it, very simple. Banks are in the business of what's called maturity transformation. They take our deposits, which are short-term obligations. They take commercial paper. They take other short-term obligations, and they convert them into loans to buy houses. They convert them into loans to corporations to build factories, and all of those are long-term loans. So what happens when there is a whiff of trouble and the run starts, all of those short-term creditors start pulling their money out. And we talked a little bit before about deposit insurance, but for a large global financial institution, deposit insurance is just the tip of the iceberg because most deposits are above the insurance limit. Most deposits are from commercial firms they're actually short-term borrowings based on so-called repo transactions with mutual funds and others. And all of those creditors are uninsured and they want to pull out immediately. They're highly sophisticated and the run starts. You know, you remember Princetonian Jimmy Stewart in It's a Wonderful Life. He was able to get all the people in town who wanted to pull their money out of the building and loan and convince them that their money was in someone else's house. You can't do that with a large financial institution, and that is why you need tools and you need planning if you are ever going to have a chance of resolving one of these large financial institutions without systemic disruption. And I define systemic disruption as being a situation where the market can't realize their value through the enterprise, and that impact then causes a contagion effect where people look around at other enterprises and are worried that the same thing is going to happen. So unless you have a system where you have properly planned for resolution and you have the tools to effectuate a resolution where that doesn't happen, you are going to have to be faced with the need for bailouts and rescues of financial institutions. So what is being done to solve this? And Richard listed some of the main items. One thing that's being done is increasing capital requirements. Now, capital is very important, but even at the capital requirements that exist now, there are some who say that it's not enough, that you need more loss absorbency. One of the characteristics of our bankruptcy system is the ability to transmit losses to creditors. And if you have long-term sophisticated creditors who know how to price the risk, there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to design a system where you can transmit the losses of the firm to that tier of creditors very quickly and remove the losses from the operating entities where the short-term liabilities are. And the effort that's being made in terms of looking at this, both from the point of view of conventional bankruptcy and from the point of view of Title II of Dodd-Frank, which is the extraordinary powers that the FDIC has to move in if necessary, involve figuring out how much loss absorbency there needs to be and how to transmit those losses very speedily and very efficiently to the creditors, and for the creditors who are extending that credit to know that they're in line to absorb the losses of the firm the way they would be in a conventional bankruptcy case. So that's the second thing that's being done, looking at loss absorbency. The third thing that's being done is regulators around the globe are now coordinating their efforts, and also significant legislation is being passed. In the United States, under the Dodd-Frank Act, as we know, we have Title II of Dodd-Frank with special tools for so-called resolution. In Europe, the Bank Resolution and Recovery Directive was passed by the European Parliament a couple of months ago. It has to be implemented across the European Union, but they also have the power to pass losses, the tools to pass losses on to long-term creditors very quickly. The regulators themselves have been gathering together in a group called the Financial Stability Board to identify how resolution should work and how the resolution regime should work. And one of their efforts, which is actively underway currently, is an effort to remove this termination problem from certain types of financial contracts so that by agreement, the market would, under certain circumstances, stay in place and not terminate those contracts and run. And I think we're going to see action on that fairly quickly. Living wills or resolution planning are exceedingly important. This is because until you get underneath the hood at a financial institution and identify all of the potential issues, whether it's issues relating to foreign affiliates, whether it's issues relating to certain types of businesses that might have to be sold, and how you would go about selling them in a speedy way. Until you do that, you are not going to be able to, as quickly as you need to, resolve financial institutions. And I would bet that the FDIC and the Federal Reserve, who are reviewing the resolution plans, are finding them very useful, not only for developing a strategy for resolving these firms under conventional bankruptcy law, but also under the special provisions of Title II of Dodd-Frank. So, in sum, There is a lot going on to try to make firms more resolvable. A lot has already happened to try to make firms less likely to fail. And it's through the efforts of Marty Gruenberg and his colleagues and their colleagues at the Federal Reserve and at the Bank of England and among the regulators around the world that we are actually beginning to make progress to solve this problem. And I will leave it to Marty to say whether he thinks it's solved.
Talk about being set up. Well, let me begin by saying what an honor it always is to be invited to participate in a program here back on campus, and particularly with this distinguished panel. And I'm struck at the turnout here for this event. I mean, I think a significant part of it is the presence of Chairman Volcker here on the panel, who I think certainly one of my heroes, if I may say, and truly one of the consequential figures of our time. But in addition, I think this issue of too big to fail actually struck a chord in the American public during this recent financial crisis in 2008 and 2009. You know, the spectacle of our largest, most powerful and privileged financial institutions being the recipients really of massive, massive, unprecedented public support on an open institution basis, essentially protecting shareholders and creditors and management. That cut across the spectrum of the American people, and I think the turnout here today is something of a reflection for that. It really got everybody's attention, and I think nobody is really happy about it. So let me just say a few words to try to put this in perspective and a little bit about what we've been trying to do to come to grips with, let me tell you, a really hard problem. And I want to pick up the story maybe a little bit where Mr. Volcker left off. He was talking about Continental Illinois and 1984, and the thrift crisis in the United States, which occurred in the late 80s, early 90s. Well, when you look back at the financial system of the United States in 1990, which is not that long ago, right, just under 25 years, I think most of the people in this room, not all, but most of the people can probably remember it. And that financial system was a very different financial system than we have today. Even in that relatively brief period of 25 years, just a couple of numbers. In 1990, the six largest bank holding companies in the United States controlled about 18% of all the assets of the industry. 18%. They made up about, compared to GDP, was about 11% of GDP. So 18% of the assets, 11% of the GDP. As of the end of last year, at the end of 2013, the six largest bank holding companies in America controlled 54% of the assets in the industry, and those assets equaled about 57% of GDP. Those are big numbers. Those are big institutions. And we've never, putting it into historical perspective, we've never really had financial companies like that in the United States before. What we have today is really not something we had 25 years ago or previously. A small set of large, complex, global companies that really dominate the financial system of the United States. I think that is the reality of what we're dealing with today. And let me tell you, we did not truly appreciate the issues those companies presented when the financial crisis developed in 2008. I think it's fair to say the conventional wisdom before the crisis was that these big firms actually had a very low probability of failure. They were diversified in terms of different business lines, commercial banking, investment banking. They were not only national in their operations, but global in their operations. And then the thought of both geographic diversification as well as business diversification made the common wisdom that these firms had a low probability of failure, and that even in a stressful environment, these companies certainly could gain access, sustain access to capital and liquidity. That was the conventional wisdom going into 2008. But the lesson we learned in 2008 was that was wrong. You know, it's a big mistake, but it was it was simply wrong. The financial markets seized up. There were significant questions about the exposures on the balance sheets of these large companies, and their ability to raise capital and attract liquidity dried up. And we had a mess on our hands that I think really was without historic precedent in the United States. People talk about this as the worst crisis since the 30s, but you know, again, as Mr. Volcker said, we had lots and lots of banks fail in the 30s, but they were pretty small institutions, created a big problem, but did not present the set of challenges and risks to the economy that these large, complex firms did in 2008. And we were really fair to say, by we, I mean the responsible agencies of our government, and I was on the board of the FDIC during that time, so I can remember it. We were quite unprepared. We did not appreciate the risks these firms posed, and we were unprepared to manage a failure of one of these companies. And given the alternatives available, the collapse of these firms really posed the possibility of a catastrophic collapse of the financial system in the United States. I mean, as it was, you know, I think this was the worst crisis in our history, followed by the most severe recession since World War II. But the fact of the matter is, I do believe it could have been far, far worse, with unimaginable consequences for our economy and the global economy as well. And so what you had, really on an ad hoc basis, was the development of a series of government interventions, essentially providing in various forms massive public support to our largest financial companies to maintain the stability of the system and prevent profound damage to the economy. I think that's what occurred, and we're talking about trillions of dollars of public support. You know, the SNL crisis, they added it up at the end, and it was $140 billion cost to the government. There was trillions of dollars of public support provided to open institutions during the course of this crisis. And, you know, I don't sort of second guess it, because I don't think it's not clear to me what the alternatives were. And the consequences were pretty overwhelming. So I don't second guess it, but I think there are a few people who view that as the optimal way to deal with this. And in some sense, all of the efforts since have been to see if we can develop some kind of an alternative scenario if we're ever confronted with this sort of thing again. And just briefly, because I want to leave, I know you all probably have a lot of questions, but and Don mentioned it, you know, there have been a series of reforms designed to lower the probability of these firms failing. And by that, I mean strengthening the capital requirements, strengthening the liquidity requirements, regulating the derivative relationships of these firms, which for over-the-counter derivatives were not regulated at all prior to the crisis. More stringent supervision of these financial companies, all of it absolutely essential to reduce the probability of failure. But the question remains, well, you know, what if all of that, you know, proves unsuccessful, and one of these firms is at a point of failure? Can we handle that? Is there anything different today than existed in 2008? And I think the answer is yes. And let me give you just a brief summary of that, and then maybe we can open it up for questions. I'm keen on this point because the agency of the government responsible for this is the one that I work for. So this is, you know, of the things I spend my time on, people ask me what keeps me up at night. This is probably the thing. And the story is this. In 2008, the FDIC's resolution powers, our ability to close financial companies, was limited to banks, to insured financial institutions. We did not have any authority over the holding companies or the affiliates of these institutions, of the banks, nor was there any authority for non-bank financial companies, which might pose a risk to the system. No public authority for the FDIC or any other agency of our government to place them into a public receivership and try to manage an orderly failure. And the most obvious example of that was the failure of Lehman Brothers, which was left to the bankruptcy process. And in retrospect, that didn't turn out so good. So what's different today? And not to get too technical, and I should warn you, this is a subject that very quickly descends into language that people have a hard time following. But the government was given major new authorities in the Dodd-Frank Act that was passed in 2010 that did not exist in 2008. Under the Dodd-Frank Act, any financial company, bank or non-bank, holding company, affiliates, can be placed into a public receivership managed by the FDIC. That authority did not exist before. And it is the nature of these companies, by the way, and it's one of the reasons that makes this such a tough problem. They're not only big, but they are complicated. And they are diverse in their operations, diverse in terms of their businesses, and they are global in scope. Trillions of dollars of assets spread among hundreds of subsidiary operations in the United States and elsewhere. So when a company like this gets into trouble, you know, well, you saw what happened in 2008. So the question is, what may be different the next time around? And let me just tell you and then stop. The authority we didn't have then that we do have now, we can take, these companies are highly integrated in their operations, and they're generally controlled by a holding company, at least in the United States. And what we can do now that we could not do in 2008 is take control of the parent holding company. And by taking control of the parent, we can effectively oversee the operations of the entire entity. And by taking control of the parent, we are able, and placing that parent company into a receivership process, it's effectively a public form of bankruptcy, we can impose the consequences of failure on the consolidated entity, meaning we can wipe out the shareholders. That's the way these companies are structured. The shareholders are at the parent. Majority of the unsecured creditors are at the parent. We can impose losses on the creditors in accordance with the losses of the company. The key management is at the top. We can remove the senior culpable management. And in to impose the consequences of failure, the discipline of the market on this company, which was something we could not do in 2008. And without getting into a lot more complicated a discussion, by taking control of that company, we can then manage what we hope to be an orderly unwinding of the company, managing the critical issues of capital, liquidity, as well as the derivative relationships of the company that can pose enormous challenges for financial stability. That's the short story. I'd be glad to respond to questions for the longer story, but it's a set of powers that didn't exist. And what is pretty remarkable, and Don referred to it, is, you know, we're not the only country in the world that had this problem. In fact, if you look at Europe and Japan, we've got big companies. They've got, relative to the size of their financial systems and economies, even bigger companies. And so Don mentioned the international organization has identified 29 of these global, systemically important financial institutions. All of the major jurisdictions, all but one, in which those G-SIFIs are located, have enacted legislation similar to the U.S., to the Dodd-Frank Act in the United States, are developing operational capabilities in responsible agencies of their government, similar to what the FDIC has been doing. And we in the United States and the FDIC and the Fed have been engaging with all of these jurisdictions, because the kicker to all of the complications here is it's not just the domestic operations. You have to be able to have an orderly management of the global operations of the company if you're going to actually allow the firm to fail. It is, as I say, a tough problem. The question is, have we ended too big to fail? I would say no. Have we made some progress in the area? I think the answer is yes. Is it fair to say it's a major priority of our government and of responsible governments around the world that are the home governments for these institutions? I think the answer to that is well. So it's one of the big issues, which is why I think a lot of you are here, and I think we'd all take a shot at answering your questions. Thank you very much.
So let me start off with a question, and then we'll take questions from the floor. So you've all commented on, and you've even personally spearheaded many of the reforms underway. Is it your view that these reforms are proceeding quickly enough? I put it in context. Christine Lagarde, Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund, had a critique earlier this week that it's going too slowly and that industry lobbying is slowing down and diluting reforms. So I wonder what your perspective is on the speed and influence on reform progress.
Nobody else is talking, I'll talk. Let me answer your question this way, or approach your question. I think we've been talking about too big to fail and bailing out and all that stuff. When you begin having those questions about how we deal with a failing bank, we've already lost. And we're supposed to be running a system that doesn't have big failing banks. You don't face these impossible jobs of what you do. So you've got to ask yourself, what went wrong, and how do we deal with it in the future? Now, we've done some talking about, I think what the FDIC has done in working with some foreign countries and trying to deal with how to, in fact, liquidate a failing institution and doing it in a way that will be least damaging to the system as a whole. They're on a very complicated, difficult track. But people don't appreciate how much progress has been made, I think. When you get the FDIC and the Bank of England and potentially the continental European banks all working in the same direction on a problem that is inherently international, because all these big banks are spread all over the place, include Japan too. I think there's a lot of progress there that has been hidden. And so far it hasn't affected attitudes very much, because there's a certain amount of questioning and cynicism about it. But let me go back. We don't want to get there. So what's going wrong? When we look back, what do we got to repair? Well, obviously something was the matter with the regulatory system, both in the structure of the system and what they did. And there have been a lot of efforts to change the regulatory system. But I don't think any regulatory system is going to solve all the problems. Don't forget, a couple of hundred yards from here, we have a department at this great university whose raison d'etre is teaching people how to get around every rule that you can conceive of to make a big bonus for a big bank. I mean, that's what financial engineering is all about when it comes right down to it. And they're very hard to keep up with. You need some regulations, but you need some good supervision. The difference is you need the rules, but you need somebody to apply the rules. And nobody can say there was any brilliant job in that respect in the past 10 or 15 years, partly for philosophic reasons. It's also true in this university, just to bring it home, that the economic thought that the market would take care of itself became predominant. I don't think it came predominant here, actually, but it became predominant in the world of economics, in the discipline. You didn't need regulation, didn't need supervision, because everybody's so clever they can take care of all the risks themselves. Well, that theory is no longer promulgated, but you do need supervision, and we have enough and put enough attention on it. And then finally, I think you have to look at not just the oversights, not just the regulation, what's going on inside these institutions. And the attitudinal change, I think, was sweeping. Somebody mentioned Jimmy Stewart, Princeton 33. There was no financial engineering then. If you get the customers in a room and say, look, we're all in this boat together and we've got to get out of it together. There's no calling the customers into a room and getting it all out together at this point. It's too complicated, not just complicated, there is too much incentive to take risk from the compensation system. 20, 30 years ago, I'm going by memory, but in the 1980s, I would say the head of the principal banks in New York City may have been making $175,000 a year. Now they're making $17 million a year or $25 million a year. And forget about them. What about all the employees that are doing deals that want to get a bonus for making some money for the institution? This great, you remember this London Whale business with Morgan Bank. I don't think Jamie Dimon probably had the slightest idea what was going on in this office in London. But when you looked at it, and there's been an investigation, they said, well, this was maturity rearranging. Apparently the email said, hey, we got a great speculative opportunity here. We made a lot of money a year ago on this fancy derivative. Let's try to do it again. There was no substance to the operation except a desire to take advantage of some perceived flaw or opportunity in the derivatives market. Understand, these credit default swaps, which they were playing around with, are supposed to protect against some loss of a credit. There's 60 trillion of these outstanding in 2008, nominal value. They're insurance policies. We had $60 trillion worth of insurance policies outstanding against $6 trillion of loans. I mean, we had 10 credit default swaps for every risk. That was not quiet, prudent banking, defending against particular risks in a particular portfolio. Obviously, speculation. It's an entirely different attitude than permeated the banking system 20, 30 years ago. And it's tied up with the compensation system, but it's tied up with a lot of other things. Banks like to send around advertisements saying the relationship is everything. The relationship is everything until they find some opportunity to make a profit. What's called the counterparty, they're not a customer. We don't have to worry about them. So I, I, I'm venting here, but. I want to ask my fellow panelists. We got a professor, we got a regulator, we got a bankruptcy lawyer intimately involved. In your judgment, given the crisis, have the attitudes inside a bank, has the culture inside these banking institutions significantly changed since the crisis? Are they more conservative, fiduciary, conscious, directed?
I'm usually quite cynical on these issues, but two or three banks that I've gotten to know pretty well internally, I think you can see evidence of a huge change in attitude. The big hiring in the financial services industry is compliance officers and lawyers to interpret the regulations. And Jamie Dimon, for example, has simply gotten out of the business of serving foreign embassies because he doesn't want to take the risk of running afoul of the anti-money laundering operations. But I think you're posing, you know, really very profound questions. And the question of compensation, I think, does go back to, can we really expect supervisors to do that kind of job? We have wonderful public servants, but typically what happens is once we train them to understand derivatives, they move right across the street into an investment bank or a bank. And until we really figure out a way to properly compensate such people, I don't think there's much hope that they're going to stay ahead. With regard to Christine Lagarde's remark, I think it is worrisome that it's taken such a long time. Dodd-Frank was passed in 2010. We still don't know what the whole thing is going to look like. Your firm actually gives you a daily report, but I think we're somewhere like 60% through implementing it, which is a very, very slow rate of progress. And even the Volcker rule, which you may want to disown at this point, came through with a lot of loopholes in it. I'm not entirely convinced that the London Whale, which really did seem to be proprietary trading masked as a treasury operation, wouldn't still fit in, because there's a pretty big loophole you can move through. And I think that is part of the process of having lengthy, lengthy phase-ins. Probably the most dramatic example of that is what happened to the liquidity regulations. They started out with a really clear concept. You wanted to look at the ratio of high-quality liquid assets, which were basically cash and treasury bills, relative to the kind of outflow you could experience in a stress scenario over 30 days. Well, it looked good on the first draft. Then the Europeans realized that it was going to really cause a problem through their banks. So you kept whittling away so that the numerator now has not only cash and bank reserves and treasury bills, but also a certain amount of stocks, some junk bonds, some corporate, you know, it's just really murky. It's not really much of anything. And the denominator has been weakened so that it really applies to no particular stress. It may be an uncomfortable situation, but heaven only, it's certainly not the kind of stress we experienced in the crisis. And that is unfortunately characteristic of a system where you have a long comment and phase-in period, because the industry really does have a huge incentive to try to manipulate the regulators, and often they do succeed. On the other hand, I think we have to worry about being too tough on the banks, because that is profitable business, and it's going to be done somewhere. It sort of goes back to an observation that Peter Cook, who was the first person to run the Basel Committee, made. Do we really want to push crime out into the alleyways where we can't see it, or do we want to keep it on the street where we can keep an eye on it? And it's a troubling question, but I think there are real reasons for concern that we cannot sustain the progress that we've made. I'm very pleased to hear Marty, however, say that he's firmly committed to going on.
Actually, if you don't mind if I intervene here, we're actually past time, unfortunately. we have a couple of people standing who have wanted to ask questions. So actually, what I'm going to do is, maybe if you don't mind, privilege them and letting them come up and ask the questions. And in the meantime, let me tell all of you, we have a reception that's about to begin right outside. So let's all first give a big round of applause to our panelists.